All right, I'm going to try to clean out these lines. And what I've done here, I have, I'm sorry about the picture quality. This fitting is a pressure wash coupler. So I took the tip out and I can connect the pressure wash gun. Well, my camera card filled up. Well, saying, as you can see, now I've got the pressure wash gun hooked up. With this tip in there, the pump will make 4,000 pounds of pressure. And with no tip and just this tubing, it won't make that kind of pressure because there's no restriction. However, it charges the hose up with pressure. And then when you open the trigger on the spray gun, there's a very high velocity jet of water goes through. Now, I've done that a few times and there wasn't a restriction that I could tell. And now I've got the soap can hooked up there with the purple soap in there. It's been in there about 15 minutes while I've cleared the camera card. So I'm going to take this tube off and put the cap back on there, because obviously that wouldn't take pressure. Cap that off and turn on the wash pump and blow it through there. So, a little water collected in there, just a couple drips down here to dry up. Alright, I've just got the gun jammed open. Circulate some water through there. Oh, now I've got a little dripping going on here. Go clean that up. Well, I've got the vacuum pump hooked up on it, pumping it down. Gonna do a little bit of leak checking with soap in a few minutes. But I wanted to show how this cold control works. I mean, you turn this, you know, obviously to set the temperature. And down here, the two little throttle cables work. And that's maximum cold, and then that's off. And you see this this lever comes up and hits that pin. And if it were running, that's running is down like that. So if you were to turn it off, it would force that up and open the contacts. The new cable's in place. And of course, the mounting springs for the compressor skid are in there. It's suspended like that, so the vibration will be minimum. Now, one thing about these, you've got to lock it down before you transport it. And it comes with these rods. Now, put the rods through there like so. And it's supposed to slide through and lock into the rear bracket. But these are not long enough. And they came from the junk fridge that Travis had. I think maybe the cabinet might be a little bit deeper on this one. So I got some longer rods to use for the lockdown rods. You can stick it in there like so. Now the real ones have a tapered end on them, so they're a little bit easier to get in. But there it goes. You can see it on there, and now it's through there. And there's another one for this side. What that does, it keeps it from bouncing off, and because these springs are just held in by hooks. So when this thing gets moved around, those rods have to go in. I'm gonna cut those to length to work with this cabinet. Now if we come back here, I put the dryer and the liquid line, and soldered together the line, return line, suction line back to the compressor. Came from the junk fridge, because mine were cut off. And then I used the dryer to splice together the liquid line. So that should give it a little longer life. And you saw the flushing earlier of this line, so hopefully there's no debris from here up to the float. If there is, then I'll have issues with that, but we're going to find out. Of course, the evaporator's in place. Lines are hooked up. I'm not putting any trim on there yet because I want to do the leak check first. Well, vacuum pump's been running for a couple hours, so I can close this off. We'll shut down the pump off camera and come right back. Now, y'all may remember when I did the work on the compressor skid, pumped it down and I put refrigerant into this receiver. So, you know, it should still have that refrigerant in there. And what I'm going to do is open the king valve back here, which I'm trying to get a wrench on right now, get the cap off. And when I open that, the valve underneath there, you ought to see refrigerant flow through that sight glass. And there's not, you know, a full charge, but there should be something that you'll see go through there. So this is going to let the refrigerant from the receiver go into the evaporator side, and then I can use soap bubbles to check for leaks. There, oh yeah. Oh, control just kicked on. All right, I'm gonna cut the camera and check for leaks with soap bubbles right now. Pretty good bit of pressure because it's warm in here. All right, I'll be back shortly. All right, I've gone ahead and started leak checking. I haven't been videoing it because I found and had to fix a leak I'm going to show. But up here, everything looks good. I don't see any bubbles. And down here on the compressor skid, I don't see anything there. Now, I'll show you where the problem was. You may notice a new solder joint right there. Well, that's because I had to cut out that first fitting where it goes directly into the compressor, because apparently this is cracked right in this area, right where the flare starts. And I don't know, it had sulfur dioxide in it when we salvaged the compressor. And apparently it was just about ready to crack, and taking it apart, putting it together, did it in. So it appears to be leak tight now, but we had that leak in it when I evacuated the system. So I'm gonna start over and evacuate again, because I know with it leaking, there was some air. So I'm gonna pull it down one more time and then we'll put some more pressure in it and go from there. All right, folks. It's got four cans of refrigerant, 10-ounce cans of R-152A. Running about 10 PSI on the low side. And if you look in there, you can see the refrigerant going through the sight glass. Very quiet to be such a lot of moving parts. Now, check that out. We have first frost. Now, between 25 and 30 on the temp gauge. And that is with no door gasket. I mean, not even, there's none installed yet. But there is a problem. It still needs some adjustments. In order for this to work, I had to close off on one of the valves, the king valve back there that restricts the high pressure liquid line. In order to get it to work right, I had to restrict that. And if I leave it open, wide open, I get a back flooding problem, which you know, the refrigerant liquid comes back to the compressor, and the compressor base starts to get cool, and the low side goes up around 30. So that tells me that the float is not closing off when the evaporator gets full of refrigerant. And remember my test I did in the sink? I tried to get it real close to that oil return port. Apparently I got it too close. So my next step is going to be to adjust that float downward and run it up again and see what happens. But I reached a stopping point for today. It is functioning and refrigerating. You know, I don't, like I said, I don't know how long ago it's been since this has functioned, but it's doing it now. .340 watts. But then again, this thing has a really large evaporator, and it has no gaskets, and it's very hot in here right now. So yeah, I'm delighted to hear it run and see it run. It's very unobtrusive with the noise. And yeah, get on getting it all together. I'm super delighted. I know I've got work to do on adjustments to make it dialed in, but man, that's going to be easy compared to what I've had to do to this point. So on that note, with a nice frosty evaporator, I'm going to wrap up this video for the day, and thanks for watching.